Hello and welcome to Newsclick. Today we have with us Harsh Mander and Seema Mustafa, and we'll be discussing the debate about how the Muslims are slowly being rendered invisible in Indian politics. Seema, you have written about this after the Gujarat elections, that the Congress seems to have appealed for the Muslim vote but kept them out of either the number of candidates put up, the speakers who are there, and even the Muslim leaders of the Congress not being visible. Do you think this is something that is far more insidious than simply targeting the Muslims, which the RSS and the BJP are doing?
Yes, in fact, you know, if you look at all the recent assembly elections after the BJP came to power at the center, the regional parties as well as the Congress, who talk of secularism, have kept the Muslims away from the front lines. The Muslims themselves, the voters tell you, that don't ask us anything. We are voting where we are voting, because they're also very aware of the fact that if the Muslim even asserts his preference, they are not going to, the vote will consolidate. And the Congress, instead of fighting this, is contributing to the RSS and the BJP's plan to push the Muslim away from the front by not fielding candidates, by not not allowing the Muslims to come out and assert their support. It's like just tucking them away, making them invisible.
Harsh, you've written this piece which has generated quite a bit of controversy, that other leaders have been saying the Muslims can come to the meetings, but they should not carry the markers of their identity. And this, interestingly enough, is something which some of the liberals have also sort of spoken about. But no such demand is being made of the markers, say, of the Iyengars who have the caste marks, or the, shall we say, other marks which are also there. And this is becoming increasingly a Hindu identity assertion, which we didn't see 30 years back, for instance. We saw yesterday, or day for yesterday, this tableau which had even Raigar as in the tableau. So do you see that this retreat of the liberal to arguing for what would be called in French terms the secular ideals, in which all religious identities are banned, but essentially asking only the minorities to come without their identity?
I think we're hurtling in that direction. And so the piece that I wrote, I really wanted to underline the fact that the BJP may have rendered the entire Muslim community politically irrelevant, but it is secular political parties which are actually rendering them politically untouchable and castaways. And it is a very conscious decision, as Seema said. I also wrote after the Gujarat elections it is so conspicuous. Even in say Rahul Gandhi's speech, it was a good speech. He spoke about the other two crises that India is facing, which is jobless growth and the agrarian crisis. But he didn't talk about the rising hate and the targeting and the lynchings that are going on. He talked about Una, but pointedly they didn't talk about the Muslim. But there's this council of despair, and I've been attending many meetings, as I wrote in my article, where Muslim friends sit together, and they actually, even they are saying that our presence, if it polarizes, let us become invisible. Almost, as I said in my article, I said they're almost saying, to save us, abandon us. And I think it is terrifying that people are even thinking about this seriously, for many reasons. One of them is that it is assuming that every Hindu is communal now. We're already in a Hindu Rashtra, and we have to sort of negotiate our political and social spaces within a Hindu Rashtra, within a majoritarian consensus. So I think that by accepting this logic, you are actually reinforcing and becomes a self-fulfilling prophecy. If instead secular political parties say that no, I mean, they should have the courage, and Mahatma Gandhi is somebody I keep remembering. I mean, imagine a million people had died in Hindu-Muslim riots, a Muslim country had been formed. People were here in anger, there were relief camps. And in the middle of that, you say, no, this country belongs in every way equally to Hindus and Muslims. And his last battle was they had taken over the Connaught Place mosque and converted into a temple, and he wanted them to be returned. I mean, I feel that is the only way that we have to fight this battle right up front. We cannot accept the logic of Hindutva and then try to negotiate, which is what I'm seeing secular political parties doing.
Of course, what the secular political parties are doing is one part. Do you also see the impact also on the Muslim community? For instance, in Gujarat, the retreat from public space, but also therefore accepting the markers of the identity, therefore, shall we say, also taking over the Muslim community by forces, which would like a kind of secluded space where the Muslim identity is asserted and political identity is not.
Yeah, I think, you know, also just before I answer that directly, I think this assault on the Muslim community began even under the Congress and under Manmohan Singh, where the intelligence network was used to target Muslims. They were arrested, innocent people in Hyderabad, locked up, beaten by the security agencies, same in Maharashtra. So this process of bastardizing the Muslim had begun, and it has become, of course, under the right-wing government and coalition today, it has become much, much worse. The Muslims in this whole period of 15 years in particular have been completely rudderless, you know, and they don't know where to go to, because what they depended on, they've always voted for non-Muslims as the Muslim leaders, and suddenly they're being told that you should have your leader who can speak for you, where are the liberal Muslims, why are others not speaking for you, and they found themselves bereft, rudderless, without sanctuary, and started then moving into all kinds of directions, which also took the form of regression. You know, so if you go to Gujarat today and you go into the villages of Gujarat, you will find hardly any women visible where the Muslim areas are, and all the Muslim men with the identity markers, because they feel that by asserting your identity, you are somehow preventing it from being subsumed under the assault. Now, that is the real issue. Are you or are you not? Is religious symbols a solution, or do they become a problem in what is a very vicious circle of communalism that is being created?
You also have written recently about the burqa, which has drawn quite a sharp response from different people,
yeah,
because of the, shall we say, the state of siege and partly the Ram Guha article. What would you say that, how do we fight these twin assaults, one for making you Muslims invisible and the other for the regression of both communities, including the Muslims?
See, it's pretty clear to me. I think that what Ramchandra Guha said about Muslims not coming to rallies in their skull caps and burqas is reprehensible and totally condemnable. I was actually coming from another side of the debate, which is a argument amongst women, Muslim women, about the hijab and about the burqa and how valid it is in today's context or yesterday's context. I think that all of us who've been part of women's movement and the secular movement have taken great, you know, very strong positions in trying to move Muslim women away from the hijab and from the burqa and from religious identity and move more towards empowerment. So it was really my argument, and what I've written is coming from that perspective. I believe that you have to take, you cannot mesh the two. You cannot say that I'm going to fight for secularism as a Muslim, or I'm going to fight for secularism as a Hindu. You are going to fight for secularism as secularists. It's a political ideology that you have to fight for, right? You cannot, I do believe that you cannot wear a tilak and a saffron dhoti, or a burqa and a beard and a pajama, and actually stand up for much more than your own identity and your own community.
Well, that's an interesting question, and Harsh, I have to look to you for answer on that. That is it possible for a Gandhi, for instance, who asserted he was a Hindu and yet was a secularist? So the religious identity and the secular identity, secularism in that sense is not a religion. How do you, negotiate this complexity of identity?
See, on the last thing that Seema said, I don't agree. And I think all of us from the left have had a problem over time in dealing with people's religious beliefs. I'm an agnostic. But, you know, when you look back, and it's important to remember in the freedom struggle that the two people who fought and sacrificed the most for the secular idea of India were Mahatma Gandhi and Maulana Azad, deeply devout you know, and Maulana had his daadis, he had his cap, he was a very deeply practicing Muslim, but he's done more. He and Mahatma Gandhi have actually, the reason why India is a country where Muslims and Hindus and people of every faith live as equals. The two people who fought most for a religious state, Savarkar was a self-professed atheist, and Jinnah was a non-practicing Muslim. So I think we're getting confused. It is not a battle. I think that with your dadi and with your tilak, you can still be deeply secular, and without any markers, you can actually be deeply. The worst in our drawing rooms. I mean, you know, all of us go to Delhi's you know, upper middle class drawing rooms, where I see the worst communalism in people who look very urbane. So I think let's do that. But I wanted to make one more point in this discussion, because we're talking about politics. I think what secular political parties are doing is deeply worrying. But I'm even more worried about secular civil society, and let me underline that. You see, what has happened, in my opinion, is that the last 4 years, it's the last 15, I think it's the last 25, it's the Babri Masjid demolition, which was the first moment of triumph for majoritarian Hinduism in this 100-year fight that they've been fighting since the formation of the Hindu Mahasabha. And since then, they never looked back, they've gone from strength to strength. But the last 4 years, I think, is a distinct phase, because we have a leadership right from the very top who has legitimized hatred and prejudice in a way that is, you know, which is brazen. And so Mr. Modi didn't ask Shambhulal Meghar to go and hack somebody to death. But he has created an environment where this kind of hatred has got legitimized. Within that, I think a sense of fear that I see that has settled in the hearts and minds of Muslim brothers and sisters across the country, across class, is something that is unprecedented. I mean, every friend is telling me, the mother says, you know, don't reply salam alaikum on a train. If I call you, somebody should make out. If there's an argument, never get into it. Never let people know that you're Muslim. I mean, this is really appalling that we have allowed our country to come to this pass. You know, in the caravan, when we go out, I've now gone to 10 states. It's not just that they're attacking Muslims, but the brutality with which they're attacking them. And we came back from Bengal, for instance. These three Muslim boys were called up, and they were called cow thieves. They were returned the bodies of their families, got their bodies with their genitals stoned. You know, where is this hatred coming from? These are strangers. So I think, you know, in this context, what is civil society doing? And I'm finding that even civil liberties groups, even progressive friends, comrades, are hesitant in the end to be seen as defending Muslims. And so in every state, I'm finding it difficult for people to come forward. So I'm saying that, okay, you know, the data shows 86% of people killed in lynching are Muslim, and 8% are Dalit. 6% are identity unknown, so it may be a little more. So I will stand with Muslims and Dalits when I'm fighting against hate violence. How can I not be standing with them? And so I think that there's a crisis. You know, we are living in these 4 years in a majoritarian consensus, nearly Hindu Rashtra. And if we accept the logic of it and then try to maneuver our progressive agendas, you know, within this, I think we've already given up the battle.
I think on that note, we're going to close this discussion. Thank you very much for watching NewsClick. Do keep coming to our website, YouTube channel, and our Facebook page.